nervous because I haven't been to a coffee shop since I was a little girl.
At least you've been to a coffee shop. I've never been to one.
Do you see their bumper stickers? Check them out.
So far away.
Okay.
Check that out.
Now, people, don't just drink your coffee today. Let it fill you. Let it inspire you. Try an Americana, a mocha latte, even a cappuccino with its rich and satisfying body. Now, I want to remind everyone, don't forget our goal of converting 500 people to coffee. Remember, bring your non-coffee drinking friends with you. Drag them here if you have to. Buy them a scone even. Just get them here. Because remember, coffee is good.
All the time.
All the time.
We feel we're the best kept secret in coffee shops. Last year alone, we had 75 new coffee drinkers, 75 new customers. We're not like those guys down the street that water their product down. We serve nothing but 100% pure coffee. Coffee is so important in everyday life, it's more important than air.
Hey, how are you doing? What can I have for you today?
I think I just want some coffee.
You've never been here before, have you?
No.
Excuse me. If this is your first time visiting with us, would you go ahead and raise your hands? We would love to welcome you.
Raise your nice and high.
Jamaluya.
We would love to get some information about you so we can follow up with you. If you could go ahead and fill those out, we'll be able to get things started. Oh, and when you bring those back to us, we'll have a special gift just for you.
We just want some coffee.
You can just go ahead and sit right over there to fill those out. That'd be great. Thank you.
What could they possibly want all this information?
You know, some people go skydiving. I serve people coffee. It's a rush. I love it. I put my heart and soul into that coffee. And there's nothing like seeing somebody take a sip of coffee for the first time in their life. We get a lot of visitors coming through. Not always do they come back, but deep down inside, I know a bean's been planted. Some people just can't take the real stuff.
Thank you, Barista Mark. It's so good to see everyone at the International Anointed First Starbucks of the Northern Valley. And I want to draw our attention to the tip jar. This is real important. I want to share with you something that happened to me when I was just a new coffee drinker right out of college. I learned that I could combine giving to my barista with my coffee, and this is the result. I found out that when I gave, my coffee came back to me, pressed down, shaken together, and running out all over. And I was a changed man. It's because the word joy, J-O-Y, means Java, others, and you. And when you include the others...
I've been thinking about National Coffee Day. National Coffee Day is coming up, you know. And it's always a big day for us, but this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to send out a direct mailer. And I'm sure our attendance is going to more than double, and it's going to change everything.
And then in 2 weeks, we're going to be serving coffee to the homeless. And you're not going to want to miss that.
What can I get you today?
I think I just want some coffee.
Okay. That'll be $3.98.
Hi. Oh, hey, what did you want to drink?
Nothing. I couldn't find the restroom anywhere. Let's just get out of here.
And there you are, sir.
Thank you.
Oh, I almost forgot. Your special gift for being a first-time visitor.
Thank you.
May your day be filled with coffee. So we'll see you next week, right?
Yeah.
All right.
Good morning. So, what if we marketed the church like Starbucks?
Well, how come places like Starbucks and those cafes and all that stuff that you walk in, you know, you're automatically going to spend more money, how do they get people back? It's not actually because of the coffee or the food, it's because of the experience. So what if you were to market the church like Starbucks? What would it take? First off, decent coffee. Well, every week people tell me how great the coffee is. Y'all come in, you say good morning, you go straight to the pot, so I'm going to guess that you like the coffee. If you don't drink coffee, we've got hot chocolate, tea, and juice, so we've got coffee, check. Welcoming faces. Well, hopefully you had a welcoming face, and if anybody has been here before, you know that if we run out of adults, we will not hesitate to grab the children or even the infants and set them up front to greet people. So welcoming faces, check. Fancy decor and paint job. Well, if you have been here at all since even January, you know how much we have changed the look of this place. First, we got the chairs, so no more cold bottoms, just in time for winter. And then we got the bathroom set up. We've got the children's room set up like a tropical island. We even gave them our own sailor hats and captain's hats. We got our carpet. We got new furniture for the lobby, which is awesome, especially when we do our small group on Wednesday nights out there. And then we just got these stage decorations, so I think we've got the fancy decor and paint job done. Check. Finally, be invited back. I want you guys to think about how you got here first. You may have seen us online. You may have seen an ad in the paper. More than likely, though, a majority of you were invited by someone else to come to church. And more importantly, once you were here, you were invited to come back. So that's what we want to encourage you all to do. National Back to Church Sunday is coming up on September 20th. That is one of two ways we have for you guys to invite people to church. Back to Church Sunday is a national event. They're marking it all over the country. And in today's world, with it being all over the country, that means it's probably going to be all over the world with the internet and everything. September 20th, we are coinciding it with our 1 year anniversary. Can't believe we've been open a year. It's been a lot of changes. Sometimes it seems like we've been open forever. And we're going to have a potluck. We are going to provide the meat. The church is going to provide the meat because we are a carnivorous eating church. And the desserts. So if you guys want to start thinking about a side dish you can bring, and also invite someone. Because as you hear Pastor Rob say all the time, it's hard to invite someone to church, but it's really easy to invite them for a free meal. And I think after a summer of potlucks, we can all agree we do pretty good food at this church, right guys? We got some great cooks. The other way to invite someone is what was on your chairs. These devotionals, which we have, they have our church address on the back, and inside they have a message from Pastor Rob and a map. And this devotional is a really, really cool way to encourage people to come to church. We've got more, so if you want to hand them out, see Pastor Rob or myself, we'll get you some. And it every day has a devotional that you can read. It starts this Tuesday, September 1st. However, I can tell you from experience, if you read the devotional and you miss a day, or you start September 2nd, or you start August 31st, God doesn't care. You can start at any time. I have picked up devotionals starting 3 weeks, 3 months later than they were supposed to. And what I love about these devotionals is it gives you a new way to look at it. And it has scripture in there. If you don't have a Bible, we've got Bibles over here. They're free for you to take. But these devotionals, we want you guys to take, and then it's really easy to just hand one and say, hey, can you read this? And then when they start to ask you questions, you can say, hey, why don't you come to church with me one Sunday and check it out? So, that's what we're encouraging you to do. We really want you guys to take the effort, and we've talked about this before, it can't seem to be really hard for people to invite people to church. It's hard for me, and I work here, to kind of go up to strangers. However, I have learned over the last year, God has shown me how easy it actually is. I've had conversations with my mechanic, in the grocery store, on the phone. You guys would not believe how many people I'm talking to in customer service, and I'm like, well, I work for a church, and then you give them the website, and before you know it, they're asking questions. My sister's coworker now brings her son to youth group because She heard me talking about it one day to my sister on the phone about the Odyssey. So, really easy way to invite people to church. It's a lot easier than you think. So we do want to invite you to church. But getting away from Sunday, we've got a couple of other announcements. First up is Starting Point, our small group. We did not meet last Wednesday because our 4-H youth group took a field trip to meet with another youth group in Bethany, but we are starting. We are going to be meeting this week, Wednesday, 6:30. We are on chapter 6. If you don't have chapter 6 or any of the other chapters, see Pastor Rob or myself. Chapter 6 is sitting on the counter. It's not too late if you haven't started coming to jump in. This is a study. You can jump in at any time and join the discussion. And it really is a discussion. I think everybody who comes will tell you we have a lot of good back and forth. We trade opinions. It's not like we come and just listen to Pastor Rob preach. We all talk about different things, about where we are in our faith. And it's just, I personally have really enjoyed some of the discussions, some of the questions that have raised, and kind of exploring where we are in our faith, because we're all at a different point in our faith journey. So, next up we have Coat Drive. We said back at the beginning of August we wanted to collect 200 coats, or cold pieces of cold weather clothing. We are almost there, so we're gonna double that. We're gonna try and collect 400 pieces. And you don't see them because they're kind of hidden everywhere, but ask those who work in the church, there are bags of clothes and coats everywhere in this church. Every closet, they're in the classroom, they're under tables. We still want more. We live in an area where Selbyville, the community, this is a great need for them. If my eyes were open to this last winter. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna collect 400 coats, and then in October, and we'll have the date for you guys, either next week or the week after, we're gonna take everything down in here, we're gonna set this up on the boutique, we're gonna invite the community to come in and shop for free coats and clothes. We will also need volunteers for that to help set up and the day before and that day of, so kind of keep that in mind. So, George, you guys are gonna be involved. All the youth group kids are like right here saying, we'll help, which is awesome, by the way, because these guys are just so about serving, and that's awesome. So, that's what we have going on. And if it is your first time, I'm not gonna give you a free coffee mug. But if you can fill out the little green card in front of you, our connection card, we do want to stay in touch with you. And even if you have filled one out before, if you have a prayer request, if you have anything you want to speak to Pastor Rob, or you need someone to pray about for you, go ahead and every week you fill those out, put them in the basket by under the light switch or the offering plate, and we will have someone, Pastor Rob will be in touch with you this week to pray with you, discuss with you, any kind of problems going on, any kind of joys. Those, we call them the connection cards because that's how we want to stay connected to you. So, that being said, before we get to the singing, I got this real talking about inviting people. Ephesians, which is written by Paul, which we've talked about Paul. Ephesians chapter 2, starting verse 19, says, so now you Gentiles, and by the way, we are all Gentiles, because if you're not Jewish, you're a Gentile. It's just two categories, you're Jew or Gentile. So all of us are Gentiles. So now you Gentiles, who are no longer strangers and foreigners, you are citizens along with all of God's holy people. You are members of God's family. Together we are his house, built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets. And on the cornerstone is Christ Jesus himself. We are carefully joined together in him, becoming a holy temple for the Lord. Through him, you Gentiles are also being made part of this dwelling where God lives in his spirit. So all of you are the church. And with that, would you bow your heads and pray with me, please? Father God, we come to you, Gentiles, young and old, rich, poor, all different stages, all different ages, but we come to you together as your children. And we ask that you be with us today as we continue to worship your name, as we continue to learn. Be with those who try and preach your word today to us. Be with us as we sing, as we pray, as we laugh, as we celebrate. Just remember everything you have done and continue to do for us. And help us learn and grow in our faith to become closer to you. We ask that you be with us as we go throughout our week. And we carry out your word and we act through our actions, show what you want us to do, which is simply to love. And it's in your Son's precious holy name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
And if you all would stand, I'm going to turn it back over to these guys.
If we gotta start sometime, why not now?
All right, praise God.
All right.
All right.
Well, that was fun. Which mic is on? Just wonder.
Whichever one you choose.
All right. All right, all right. That was fun. It's good to cut off the music every once in a while and just listen to the voices. I wish we said we did it on purpose, because we did not, but but it was still pretty cool, and I just think that was pretty cool. But so we're getting to the part where we collect, where we pass the basket, do the tithes and offering, and I just want to give a shout out to our volunteers that stepped up in the church for the longest. I'll just say maybe probably about January and previous times, you know, majority of the lead team was very few. I mean, we had to wear a lot of hats, but ever since then, we've had more people coming in and stepping up, and we have new things going on, like Forge. Forge is totally being run by Rob Shrees and Tara and Trish whenever she can. And of course, we have the Bible study that's been coming up. We have the Coke Drive, and I just want to say that it's not that money isn't the only thing that's important. It's time, and it's through your offering of time that we can get more things going on for the church and bring more people here to hear the message that they need to hear and to feel the love that they need to feel. And I just want to just go ahead and take us to the Lord in prayer.
All right.
Dear God, I thank you for this beautiful Sunday morning. I just pray, Lord, that you bless everyone who's in here. I just pray that, you know, for those who maybe be here for the first time, that they realize it's no accident that they're here, that you want them here. They're supposed to be here today, this morning in this church. Just pray, Lord, that you bless the pastor with the message, and that we all have our hearts and our minds open to what he needs to say to us, so we can receive, and that whatever we learn here, whether it's through the music or through the message, that we go out through the week and we apply it to our everyday lives. And I pray this in your heavenly name. Amen.
Amen. You guys can come out now. Becca, you ruined the surprise. I saw your car across the street. Plus, it's not my birthday for another 2 weeks. What's going on? Is everything okay?
Thanks for coming, son.
Sure, yeah, this is my house. I live here. What are you guys doing here?
Why don't you take a seat, son?
We're all here today because we love and care about you so much, and yeah, we just have some concerns, honey.
Concerns? Like what?
Well, we've seen some of the pictures that you've posted on Twitter, and I must say, I do not approve of some of your activity.
First of all, it's Twitter, and secondly, I don't know what pictures you're talking about.
This, son. This.
What's wrong with fishing?
It's not what you're doing. It's what you're not doing.
Instead of fishing for fish, how about you start fishing for men?
I think what your dad's trying to say is that Sundays aren't meant to be spent at the lake. You should be spending your time with us, where you belong, at church. We're really worried about you, Jake.
Church? That's what this is all about?
Look, son. You've got a choice to make. You can either come to church with us, or you'll be spending all your time at the lake. The lake of fire.
And brimstone.
Inviting someone to church doesn't have to be like an intervention. Just ask.
So you're going down there fishing? Pastor said, no. Actually, I guess we are. I'm going to be fishing for a minute. Guy looks at him with a real strange look and says, good luck with that. Walks away. In today's world, you really have to be careful how you talk. But once again, I do really want to welcome you all for coming today. It's such a pleasure to have you here with us. And I'm really excited about what God is doing in our church. We have so many things going on. If we couldn't do it without your support, both financially and time and price, it's just wonderful. God's using all kinds of things. And these devotionals that we have, I wish I could take credit for the inside. I can't. But we had a company contact us as part of their promotional to try to get us to be customers as they designed for it at a really great price. But it just happens to be my favorite devotional, or one of my favorite devotionals, the guy who puts it out. So you may recognize it as you start to read the inside. But it's a great witness tour. It wasn't necessarily just for our church. We to get people to come here, we put the directions on the inside, but we put those around town. They're in some of the restaurants, they're in the post offices. We put them around town so we can get the Word of God into people's hands. Because a lot of books can inform you, but only the Word of God can transform you. So we have this big event coming up on September the 20th. We're combining our national comments not for me.
I like this.
Yeah, Lord. Selbyville, Lord. Odyssey Church. That's right. That's where I'm supposed to be, right? Sunday? There's a lot of them here. Yeah. Sure. Okay, all right, I'm going to listen. Sure, absolutely. Yeah, okay, can I put you on hold? I'm sorry, but okay, let me just put you on hold for a minute, okay? All right, I'll talk. Oh, hey, how are you doing? How are you doing? Gee, how have you been? Gee, you look wonderful. What's it been, like 4 or 5 years? Yeah, maybe a little more than that. I don't worry about God. He'll wait. I can tell by the way that you're looking at me that you just have no idea who I am, do you? No, I can tell. You're sitting there looking up at me and you're thinking, no, you don't know who I am. But, frankly, I can't believe that. It just seems to never fail. I mean, it happens to me all the time. You know, all those long hours that we spent together, and all those sleepless nights that I put you through. Let me refresh your memory. You see, I'm your prayer. No, you still don't remember me. I'm that one. You remember me now? Take a look at this side. This is my good side. No? How about my other good side? No, still nothing. And, 4 or 5 years, it's really not been that long, has it? Or maybe it has. I guess maybe now that I'm your forgotten prayer. I just can't believe it. I kept you up all those nights. You rolled around in bed, and we just
we struggled, and all those tears that you shed over me. You can tell when you're looking, you just don't remember. How about the 3 days that you spent fasting for me? You remember that? Remember the 3 days that you spent fasting for me? That was really something. Really something. 3 days with nothing but water. Well, yeah, water and that Snickers bar that you snuck in the break room there. Yeah. God saw that. He saw it. But, you know, not to worry. Not to worry. He didn't hold it against you that you ate some candy. I mean, God doesn't care about that. And, you know, he was keeping an eye on you. He knows in your heart what you were doing. And, you know, he didn't even care that you took that 30-minute break to watch Everybody Loves Raymond. Everybody loves Raymond. God loves Raymond. You know, he didn't hold that against you. But I gotta tell you, God's mind was already made up. It's not that he didn't hear you. It's just that he was waiting for your mind and your heart to open up.
Amen.
Yeah. You see, I was all set to come to you. I really was. I mean, I was looking good. I was ready. I felt so bad hearing you beg to God over and over again that I would come to pass. And frankly, who could blame you? Who could blame you? For all you knew, I was the answer that you needed. You thought you had it. I was there for you.
And I looked
good. Come on. It was a beautiful prayer. Look at me. I thought I was going to get it done for you. I even went to the Lord. I said, please, Lord, please. Come on, we can get this done. I'm worthy, aren't I, Lord? And he looked at me and he said, sure. You're worthy. All prayers are worthy. But I have something better. And you know what that something was, don't you? Of course you do. That answer is the reason that you forgot me. But it's okay. It's okay. I see you sitting there. You look happy. I think things worked out for you. I think it worked out for the better, right? Well, maybe for the best. Because you see, that's how God works. He works in his own time, and he works in his own way. I mean, sometimes that you think God is holding out on you, sometimes you think that he's holding back on the one thing that you need the most. But really, he's just waiting to show you something. It's even better. Sometimes you can't really conceive of it. But you can bet that he's working for you.
Amen.
He's listening to you.
Amen.
He's got your back. He's there all the time. Well, look, I was just here in the neighborhood, and I just wanted to stop in and say hi and reminisce a little bit about the time that we shared. You know, I won't be the last unanswered prayer that you're going to run into. Not a chance. There's going to be others. All through your life, there's going to be more. In fact, maybe you're dealing with one right now, as we sit here. In fact, I'm quite sure you are. And you know, if you are, I just want you to go easy on the guy. And above all, don't get mad at God. He may not do everything that you ask. He may not do it in the time frame that you have. But there's one thing for sure, absolutely positive. He loves you very, very much.
Amen.
He'll do what's best for you, and he'll never leave you.
Amen.
So I think I see an old friend back there. I think maybe I'll go see how things are going. Oh, one second. Hey, God. Yeah, it's me. Yes, yes, still here at Odyssey Church. It's a great little church. I know, I'm going to get right back on it. You know, there's not enough of us here. I know. I hear them all, Lord, every day. He said to tell you he hears your prayers. Yeah. He says you can't pray enough. Oh, really? Really? Okay, all done. Wow. He said, again, he loves you very much. He hears your prayers. He wants me to tell you that you can't pray enough. And when going gets tough, if you think you're praying, then pray more. Amen.
Bill Lord, and just to throw him a little plug out there, he owns Lord's landscaping, so Bill Lord sort of told me what he was going to do this morning, and but he didn't tell me the whole thing, so when you put God on hold, I wasn't sure how this was going to go. I had to tell you. And forgive me, I'm still trying to get used to this new setup, so I'm trying to figure out a spot that I can sit and still see you and you see me, and it don't look like I'm trying to separate myself from you and let you still see the screen. So sooner or later, I'll figure it out. But I really do appreciate Bill. I've known Bill for quite a while now, and truly one of the guys that walks his walk. You know, I believe that we've all probably prayed for some things at some point in time, and we've forgotten what we even prayed for. You know, there were times when we prayed, and they were important things, they were big at the time, but God answered our prayers in a way that we didn't expect. And as we're going through that difficult time, it didn't seem like he was answering at all, but in hindsight, you can see that God was there all the time. Maybe you even forgot, like Bill said, the prayer that you had prayed. You know, maybe you were praying for one job, and it didn't come through, and you felt devastated. But all of a sudden, you got another job, and that job gave you more money and more benefits. And if you'd taken the other job, you'd have missed out on this one. You know, I know people who prayed diligently, a certain person that they thought was the one would ask them out so they could go out. And they just knew if they could get that person, they'd be happy. And God just never seemed to answer that prayer. But one day, somebody else came along, and because they were available, because they weren't tied up with this other person, they didn't get God's good. They got God's best. And I think sometimes how often that happens in our life. I read somewhere that God's unanswered prayers are sometimes His very best for us. And Bill reminded us, and I'm so appreciative, that God loves each and every one of us. He always has our best interest at mind. You know, he sort of ended by saying, maybe there's somebody in here that's struggling with what's going on in life. Maybe there's somebody in here that's struggling with a prayer that's important, it's big in their life, and they're praying. It doesn't seem like God's answer. You know, maybe there's a period of time. In fact, I would say in a crowd this size, there's several people in here that are just praying for God to come through. And it doesn't look like He's going to. In fact, it doesn't seem like God may even care at all. You know, here's what I think. I think sometimes we're like that little child who has to go in and get a vaccination. He has to go get in a needle. And all the child can think about is how much that needle's going to hurt. They're focusing right on that needle and nothing else. And they don't understand. They don't know that by getting this short-term pain, it's going to save them a lifetime of maybe disability, maybe save their life altogether, save them a lifetime of trouble and suffering so that they can live life and live it more abundantly. But all they can see is the shot. They can't see what the result is going to be. When we go through trials and tribulations, I think most of us, what we do is we focus on the problem instead of focusing on God.
Amen.
And God desires for us to focus on Him and let Him deal with the problem.
Amen.
Yeah, I remember one of the most tough things that I was going through at one time as our business began to have just one offset after another. I mean, things were great. I mean, at one time. I mean, this was a business that was going to allow us to retire early and retire wealthy. And at one time, it really looked like that way it would be. We had real estate. We had business was going good. We had a lot of receivables. But then all of a sudden, things began to happen in the economy. You know, we made some bad decisions. I'm not going to put all the blame on the economy. All of a sudden, what looked like was a sure thing began to sort of self-destruct. And I remember begging God, praying God, please don't take our business away. Please don't take our retirement away. Please don't let my house be gone, the things that we've worked so hard for. Please, Lord. And the more I prayed, it seemed like the worse it got. And I mean, I'm going to tell you, maybe you're all more spiritual than I am, but I'm not beyond bargaining with God. You know, I'm telling him, I'm saying, you know, Lord, your name is on the line too. We run a Christian business. We got a cross in our symbol, in our logo. We got a fish in our logo. People know we run a Christian business. So if this fails, you fail. You know, and I mean, like I said, I'm confessing here. You know, I thought maybe if I was good enough, if I would try, you know, if I would just try to be a better person, God would save my business. You know, I did everything that I could, but it just constantly got worse and worse and worse. I thank God. You know, I'd like to say I do it every day, but as often as I thank God for never answering that prayer. Because honestly, if I did, I'd never been able to help launch this church in Shelbyville, Delaware. I'd never be able to see some of you in here who I've seen not just confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, but as the Holy Spirit begins to transform your life, as only the Holy Spirit can do. That there's people in here that are closer and nearer to God. And if God had answered my prayers, He would have probably done that in your life, but I had never got to be part of it. So I thank God for not answering my prayers at that time. Isaiah 55:8 says, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord. And my ways are far beyond anything you could ever imagine." I think to myself, if God had answered her prayers, I may have had a tremendous amount of worldly success. But that would have only been God's good. It would have never been God's best. So I thank Him for not answering it. Now I want you to try to sort of imagine this little story in your head. I want you to try to picture this in your mind's eye. You're a very, very successful business person. You know, you have just about everything you could ever dream of. You've got the perfect job. You've got the perfect spouse. You have four beautiful kids. You have money in the bank. Everything looks wonderful in your eyes. But all of a sudden, things start to change. In your business, there's been an accident. And that accident has pretty much destroyed your business. There's going to be lawsuits that come against you. And everywhere you look, all you can see is the evidence of what's happened. It wasn't your fault. It just happened. But that's all you can see. That's all you can focus on. And you're about ruined financially. And because this is all you, your head just can't wrap around it. So you decide to take your family on a cruise. You're going to go on a cruise ship. You, your wife, and your four kids. And you're just going to try to put it aside for a while. Get your mind clear. This is going to give you a chance to rest. Think about it and focus on what you're going to do next. And you're just about to leave to go on that cruise ship. When somebody comes up and hands you a piece of paper and you open it, and you find out that you have to be in court the next day. You're at the brink. You're at the dock. And there's nothing that you can do. But the trip's already prayed for. And you're a Christian. So you say, "Honey, tell you what. Why don't you and the kids go along? You all go. And before you go, just let me bow down and pray for you for safe travels. All the things that we do. And, you know, sometimes I think we do it half-heartedly. We're praying for safe travel. And we're thinking, hey, God's going to get the safe travel. Why, you know, why are you praying for this? Put our seatbelts on. Let's go." But you pray for it. And you go in, and the next day you're starting to prepare for court. You go to court. Things don't turn out exactly your way. And a couple of days later, you get a phone call. It's your wife, and she's crying. She's uncontrollable. You can't figure out what's going on. And you start asking, "Honey, what's up?" Finally, you get it out of her. It's been a tragic accident on the ship. All four of our kids have died. Now your world is crumbled. I mean, you've been praying for your business. You're a Christian person. Things have always been great for you. God has always blessed you. What's going on? Your business is gone. And now your children are gone as well. Everything you prayed for is disappearing. What do you do? I mean, do you think God can take that chaos, that tribulation? Do you think He can bring something good out of that?
Yes.
I mean, can you have peace in a situation like that?
Yes.
I mean, your kids are gone. Your business are gone. Everything you ever dreamed about is gone. And you're standing there alone, and you know you have to get on a plane and go meet your wife. And you don't even know what you're going to say to her. You don't even know whether you need to run from God or run to God. Life is a mess all of a sudden. What do you do? Well, I'm going to tell you a true story about a man named Horatio Spafford. You may already know his story. If you don't know his story, I almost promise you you'll know his work. 1888, I believe. He was a wealthy Chicago lawyer, and because he was so wealthy, he had just about everything he could dream of. He had a beautiful house. He had money in the bank. He invested in properties. He had four beautiful daughters. And he had a wife who loved him, and he loved. And not only did he have all this thing, he was known as a man around town as a man who walked his walk. I mean, he never had to tell anybody he was a Christian. Because when he talked to you, you knew he was a Christian. You could tell by his actions. You could tell by his walk that he was exactly who he said he was. In fact, in his church, he was known as one of the good ones. He was one of the ones that, hey, there's no hypocrisy in him. He is what he says he is. And because of his wealth, because of his Christianity, he hung around people. He hung around people like D.L. Moody. And I don't know if you know that name, but you ever heard of the Moody Institute? All right? D.L. Moody was a great Christian man, still affects people today. Ira Sankey, all these other famous Christians, the Billy Grahams of the time. Life was about as good as it could get for one person. He had everything he had dreamed for. But then, something happened. 1871, there was a fire in Chicago called the Great Chicago Fire. And because of his wealth, Horatio Spafford had invested in a lot of real estate in the area that was most affected by the Great Chicago Fire. It virtually wiped him out financially. Then in 1873, there was a huge financial downturn in our nation. And what little bit he had left was just about gone. I mean, here's a man who had everything financially, and now he has virtually nothing. And to make matters worse, he had just planned to go to England with his wife. Taking their four daughters, they were going to cross, and this was going to give his wife and his daughter some time to sort of heal their wounds, lick their wounds from all that had happened to them in the past couple of years. But this great man, Horatio Spafford, still had a tremendous faith in God. So he's not just going to England to lick his wounds and heal his wounds. He's going to evangelize. He's meeting D.L. Moody and Ira Sankey in this great England revival. So here's a man who's lost about everything, and he is still working for the Lord. At the last minute, there's a zoning problem because of the Great Chicago Fire, and he can't go. He has to handle this business problem. So he prays for his wife, he prays for his kids, and puts them on the cruise ship. As they're crossing the ocean, their ship hits another sea vessel, and their ship goes down very quickly. And what's now a famous telegraph comes from England from his wife. Two words. Saved alone. Saved alone. He knows immediately what it means. Now he's lost everything. Lost his business, lost his property, lost his wealth, lost his children. And he has to gather himself together and go meet his wife in England with this heavy, heavy heart. As he's headed, of course, at that time they didn't have airplanes, so he boards a boat. It's going to take him to his grieving. His wife's name was Anna. It's going to take him to his grieving Anna. And they get to about the spot where his wife's ship went down. The captain comes to him and he tells him, this is where it happened. Horatio Spafford penned these words that have comforted so many people. It is well with my soul. When sorrow like the sea billows roll, it is well think about this. For almost a century and a half now, the tragic story of one man, the tragic story of one man has brought great hope and great comfort to countless of thousands, maybe 100,000, who have lifted up their arms and sang, "It is well with my soul." But here's the thing, the story doesn't end there. Most people know up to this part, but the tragedy doesn't stop there. Him and his wife have three more kids. They have two girls, Bertha and Grace. They have a son that's named Horatio after his father. And at 4 years old, Horatio gets scarlet fever and dies at 4 years old. Now, he's part of a Presbyterian church, and the Presbyterian church begins to think and talk about Horatio Spafford as if there has to be some kind of sin in his life. Otherwise, God would not be doing what he's doing to Horatio and his family. He knows there's no sin in his life, but everybody else begins to do that. And the church that should have brought him comfort, the church that should have brought him love, has turned their back on him and is spreading vicious rumors about him. I think to myself, what would I do in a situation like that? Horatio Spafford, he doesn't let that deter him. He goes in and he sort of starts a new sect of Christianity, one that was actually named the Overcomers by the American press. Him and his wife decided they're going to head to somewhere near Pakistan. They're going to head to the Turkish Pakistan, somewhere around Ottoman, I think. They end up in Jerusalem. They settle in Jerusalem. And it's about the time of World War II. They start this group they call the American Colony. Colony members later get joined by a bunch of Swedish Christians, and they have no hidden agenda. They just love everybody. They didn't care if you were Muslim. They didn't care what your faith was. They didn't care if you were Christian or Buddhist. They just loved them. And because they didn't have any hidden agenda, people opened up their hearts to them. And after World War I, this area is destructive. You know, it's just destruction. There's poverty. And they continue to bless the people by opening a soup kitchen, by helping in the hospitals, by taking other charity organizations and passing out the things that these people need that are so desperately needing help and love. Horatio Spafford, there's a movie called Jerusalem, or a book called Jerusalem, was written about this American colony. Think about this. As these tragic events in his life, he never once ran away from God. He knew God had bigger plans for him than he had for himself. And he knew that God loved him in spite of what the circumstances looked like. And because of that, so many people have come to know the living God. God's thoughts are not like our thoughts. His ways are far beyond anything we could ever imagine. So I want to know, you know, if you're struggling this morning, if you're struggling with unanswered prayers, if you're struggling through great trials and tribulation in your life, that you're not alone. I want you to know that there's a great many believers who struggle. In fact, I would even go as far to say, I bet there's very many devout Christians, devout people of faith, who may not even believe that God hears our prayers or answers our prayers. If you're one of those people, and you're in a situation, like Bill says, God loves you. And he doesn't just love you like we think of love. He loves you with an everlasting love. And he may not be answering your prayers right now, but I assure you, he has only nothing but the best interest in mind for you. Sometimes, you know, we come to people and say, well, God's not answering my prayers. And they give us these pat answers. But I'm telling you, when you're in grief, when you're crying out to God in despair, I don't think somebody telling me, you know, God always answers your prayers. It's either yes or no, or wait a little while. I don't think that helps a whole lot. Not when you're in the depths of despair. Not when you're crying out to God with everything that you have in you. But I want you to know this. I'm not, and you're not, the first person ever to have unanswered prayers. Now, I've had a lot of unanswered prayers in my life. But I can tell you, when I look back, some of them I can't quite explain right now. One day I believe that they'll be revealed to me in heaven. But other ones I can see clearly why God did what he did. And I almost promise you, in my foolishness, there's been many prayers that God didn't answer that I've forgotten about. But if I remembered them, I would just look myself in the mirror and say, what in the world were you thinking when you prayed that? But I find great comfort in the Bible. Because all throughout the Bible, there's these examples of great men and women of God whose prayers weren't answered. And sometimes the Bible gives us explanations as to why they weren't answered. But more often than not, we don't get the explanation. We just know God didn't answer that prayer. They're in a moment of crisis. They're crying out, God, help me. For whatever reason, God decides not to answer that prayer. And maybe, just maybe, there's some of you that are in that same situation today. You know, one of my favorite accounts of unanswered prayer is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. It's the Apostle Paul. Apostle Paul has an unanswered prayer. Paul says, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan to torment me. 3 different times I begged God, the Lord, to take it away. But each time he said, my grace is all you need. Now, I look at the Apostle Paul. If you don't know who the Apostle Paul is, Apostle Paul was a great man of God. I mean, God used Paul to write most of our New Testament chapters. God used Paul in ways that we can't even begin to comprehend for ourselves. And Paul, in his obedience, I wonder how many prayers, this is the only one recorded, but I wonder how many prayers they've gone unanswered for Paul. Lord, please don't let them whip me. Please don't let me whip them again, because he says he was whipped 3 times. Lord, please don't let them stone me. They said he was stoned and left for dead. Lord, please don't let me be shipwrecked. And he was shipwrecked more than once. I wonder how many prayers Paul prayed who wasn't answered. And here's Paul, probably the greatest Christian ever to walk the earth. I mean, he's the one that brought Christianity to Europe. And God don't even just say, Paul, you know, you got to wait, maybe, if you do this. He just comes out and says, Paul, I have no intention of answering your prayer whatsoever. My grace is all you really need. See, I think Paul teaches me, and hopefully he'll teach you as well, that some important things. First of all, unanswered prayer comes to some of the greatest Christian people that you ever come across. God doesn't reserve unanswered prayer to the person who's in sin. God says no matter where you're at in your walk, there are going to be times that you pray that I'm not going to answer your prayer. So first of all, unanswered prayer comes to all of us, no matter how close you are to God. Second thing is, I don't think in our humanness that we can truly understand unanswered prayers. I don't think that sometimes we can look back with 50-50, you know, 20-20 hindsight, and we can see it, but in the midst of trials, in the midst of tribulation, in our humanness, it's hard for us to understand that God has a bigger purpose for us because we're hurting and we're in pain. Yeah. Just doesn't seem logical to us in some cases. And third, when you have unanswered prayer, remember that God has a higher purpose for you. I mean, I want you to think about it this way. What if God had answered all those prayers that I was praying years ago to save our business? I would have missed out on all of this. I would have had God's good, but I would have never got God's best. Would I be closer to God today if he'd have answered those prayers and allowed our business to be successful and me to become wealthy and recover? Doubt. What if God answered all your prayers, every prayer that you ever prayed? I mean, forget for a moment that some of them were probably prayed in foolishness or short-sightedness. Now, what if he answered every prayer? Would you draw closer to God, or would you draw farther away from God? See, God's much more concerned about your eternal salvation than he is your earthly comfort. He always has your best interest in mind. Paul even went on to say, I was given by my power works best in weakness. So now I am glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults and in the hardships and in the persecutions. I mean, I wonder how many times Paul just prayed, Lord, please don't let them do this to me. Lord, please take me out of this. Paul, don't let me be persecuted. Don't let me have these troubles that I suffer for Paul. But now he's saying, I take pleasure in this, for when I am weak, then I am strong. You know, the fact is, as hard as it is for us to swallow, sometimes our prayers, like the Apostle Paul prayers, just aren't simply going to be answered. But I don't think any prayer is ever wasted. I think God hears every single prayer, whether he decides to answer them or not. I think he hears every prayer. It might be the unanswered prayer that draws you closest to him. Because seldom are we in our knees in times of great prosperity. But in those times of tribulation, we spend an awful lot of time with God. See, I think that the problem lies somewhere along these lines. When we pray, we tend to focus on the answer and the problem and not on God and his solution. Now, I know that I can't speak for everybody. I just know that for myself. When I'm praying, I'm sort of giving God my checklist and the things that I want him to do. And God says, you know, well, if I answer that, do you know what would happen to you? I got this and it's better for me. But we're in the midst of that. We can't see it. So what do we do when God doesn't seem to answer our prayers? Let me offer three suggestions. First, as Bill said, you just keep on praying. Just keep on praying. Don't stop praying. See, I'm going to tell you, I wasn't always a pastor. I did a lot of things in this world. And my mom and my grandmother prayed for me for decades for me to accept Christ. And the more they pray sometimes, the more I think I ran away. And my grandmother died, never seeing me come to Christ. And I think as she continued to pray for me, she must have thought, God, why aren't you answering my prayers? And she never saw it answered. She died thinking God wasn't going to answer the prayer. The last church that I pastored, we had a man in there. His wife had been praying for him for over 40 years to start coming to Jesus and find Christ. For over 40 years. One day, after I'd been there for a couple years, he decides just to visit the church for some kind of special occasion we had. And then he decided to come back again. And one day, he asked Jesus to be Lord over his life. 40 years she prayed. I got the great privilege of being able to baptize him. But just a couple weeks, maybe a couple months after he was baptized, he found out his cancer had come back. And after a brief but brave battle, he died. Then I got the honor of doing his funeral. Much easier to do a funeral for somebody that you know is spending eternity wrapped in the arms of Jesus. And I think to myself, what if she'd stopped praying? Would God still have done the same thing? He could have. But would he? Don't stop praying. The second thing is, let God be God. Just let God be God. Acknowledge the fact that God has the right to say no. Because whether you accept that or acknowledge it, doesn't change the fact that he still has the right to say no. And if you let God be God, then guess what? You can stop playing God. Let God be God, because I'm going to promise you from experience, when you let God, you will sleep better at night knowing that he's in control and you don't have to be in control anymore. And then third, just keep on doing what you know is right. See, the darkness of unanswered prayers and the darkness of unanswered prayer, we're tempted to give up on God. You may just feel like throwing in the towel and all the Christianity and running away. Where would you run to? Just keep on doing what you know is right. Keep on praying. Keep on believing. Keep on reading your Bible. Keep on obeying God and following the Lord. And if you stay on course, the darkness will eventually become light. the light will shine again, and you'll be glad you didn't give up when things got tough in the moment of your disappointment. You know, one of my favorite devotionals, besides this one, is one called Utmost by My Highest by Oswald Chambers. Most people don't know this, it's actually written by his wife. He died at a very early age, and his wife took his old sermons and put it together to come up with this devotion. But on the very first page, January the 1st, Oswald Chambers takes a scripture that Paul wrote to the Christians in Philippi. From Philippians chapter 1, verse 20, and it says, "For I fully expect and hope that I will, as I have been in the past, and I trust that my life will bring honor to Christ, whether I live or whether I die." Oswald Chambers says it's as if Paul was saying, my determined purpose in life is to give Christ my utmost for His highest. I think we could even add today, I want to live for Christ whether He ever answers another prayer of mine or not. Chambers goes on to write, it's as if Paul were saying my determined purpose, but he goes on to say, to reach that level of determination, and this is so important, to reach that level of determination is a matter of will. It's not a matter of debate, and it's not a matter of reason. It's just simply a matter of will. An undue amount of thought and consideration for ourselves is what keeps us from making that decision. As we said earlier, we're concentrating on us and not on God. We're concentrating on our problem and not His solution. Paul says, my power works best in weakness. Can you say the same thing this morning? See, I think what God does, and Oswald Chambers sort of says the same thing, because we're unresponsive to God's gentle nudges, because we're unresponsive to the gentle nudges, He begins to place us in somewhere in a crisis. He begins to allow crisis to come into our life. He's there to bring us to where we have to make a decision. Will we let Jesus be our utmost for His highest? And we have to decide for or against. That moment, in that moment, many of you experience, you already are in that moment, it comes a crossroad in our life. In crisis, we have to make a decision. Are we going to run to God or are we going to run from God? And if crisis has come to you on any front, I'm just begging you, and I'm talking from experience, surrender to God's will. Because if you don't, the battle gets longer, and the battle gets stronger. So surrender before you become even bloodier than you already are. Have you surrendered your life to the one who gave His life for you? Apostle Paul says, my power works best in weakness. So now I am glad to boast about my weaknesses so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults and the hardships, persecutions and troubles that I suffer for Christ. When I am weak, I am strong. If you're in the middle of chaos, if you're in the middle of trials and tribulation, if you're in the middle of an unanswered prayer, can you say like Horatio Stafford, it is well with my soul? You know, I don't think there's any other way better to close out this service than having us all sing that wonderful song. So I'm going to ask our worship team to come forward and lead us in this beautiful hymn. One that was written in the ugliest, this beautiful hymn that was written in the ugliest of circumstances. It is well with my soul. Is it well with your soul this morning? If it's not, will you allow me to pray for you? If you're going through a difficult time, if you have unanswered prayers, if God seems distant, if you never surrendered your will to His will, will you let me pray with you this morning? And folks, if you've never made the decision to make Christ not just your Savior, but to make Him your Lord, may today be the day of your salvation. Because here's why it's so important. Because not only will it be your soul be well today, it'll be so well for all of eternity. And I want us to sing as we know that God is our audience. I want us to sing as if we know that God has gathered His Son, His angels all in heaven, and they're looking down upon us. And let's sing like we want to make them smile.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Is it well with your soul?
Yes.
You know, Paul tells us that we see dimly now. We see dimly now as we march on through these shadows of life. But the day's going to come. The day's going to come when the sunlight of God's love is going to shine. And not just for a little while. It's going to shine for all eternity as we stand in the presence of Jesus Christ, who loves us and who gave Himself for each of us. But until then, we sort of got to move through the twilight, don't we? We got to know that some of our prayers aren't going to be answered, no matter how hard we try. But you know what? We're on a journey. We're on an odyssey, if you will, to our home. And this ain't it. We have a God who loves us so much that sent His Son to die for us so that we can spend all eternity in His home. And see, God didn't say, as we pray, God didn't say, my answers are sufficient for you. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. So I want to thank you this morning for joining us. We pray that you'll come back again, and it's just a pleasure to have you with us. I want you to know that. Now, I want to let you know, I don't expect to be interrupted next week, so I want you to come back, and I want you to bring a friend, if you will. And may the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you and among you wherever you find yourself this week. Enjoy the rest of the day, and I pray that it is well with your soul. God bless each and every one of you.